Democracia tem a ver com igualdade, representatividade, liberdade de escolha. Mas mesmo nos países de maior tradição democrática, persiste uma dúvida. Como reduzir o poderio econômico nas eleições? Cidadania recebe um estudioso deste tema, o Dr. Craig Holman, representante da organização não governamental Public Citizen junto ao Congresso americano. Seja bem-vindo aqui, Dr. Holman.
Thanks for inviting me.
Dr. Holman, o que aconteceu com a legislação americana de 2002 e depois em 2010, que parece que a transparência foi agredida de alguma forma, diminuiu a transparência no financiamento das campanhas eleitorais?
Well, throughout recent history, throughout the recent decades in the United States, we've been building a strong campaign finance system. In 1907 was the first time we banned corporate expenditures in elections. Then in the 1970s, following the Richard Nixon Watergate scandal, we passed the Federal Election Campaign Act that set up strict contribution limits. Literally, no matter how wealthy you were, you could only give $1,000 to a candidate. That was the limit, and that applied to everybody. And then in 2002, we went the next step that needed to be done, and that is to get full transparency of where all the money's coming from. We had abandoned corporate spending, we had contribution limits set up, then in 2002, we passed the McCain-Feingold law that required full transparency of where all the money's coming from. So we had a good system in place. You know, a very reasonable system of regulation of money and politics. And it all fell apart on January 21, 2010, when the new U.S. Supreme Court that George Bush had appointed, President George Bush had appointed two new members to the court, that shifted the court 5-4 to very conservative. And this new court decided that it was going to go all the way back to 1907 and invalidate the ban on corporate spending in elections. It declared in the decision called Citizens United that corporations are to be treated as persons under the First Amendment and therefore can spend unlimited amounts of money in elections. With that huge blow, we lost everything we've gained through the decades when it comes to reasonable restrictions on money and politics. As a result, by the way, the 2016 elections is going to be the most expensive, the messiest, and the darkest election we've ever seen in American history.
Quando o senhor fala de dark money, de dinheiro de origem obscura, o senhor está tentando conceituar que tipo de contribuição, quem está por trás disso?
Dark money is a term for not knowing where the money is coming from. We don't know the sources of the money. What happened in the Citizens United decision is it unleashed corporate spending in elections. Now, if corporations were to actually buy an ad themselves, for or against a candidate, they'd have to put the name of the corporation on the ad. Chevron Corporation is paying for this ad supporting Donald Trump, for instance. And corporations don't want to do that. They don't want to offend their consumer base. So they don't want their name associated with any particular candidate or party. So what they found that they could do is they can take that money and instead launder it through a nonprofit group, say the American Chamber of Commerce, or any other number of nonprofit groups, and arrange through that nonprofit group that it be spent in elections for or against a particular candidate. The money gets spent, that ad happens, but we don't know where that money came from. All we know is that the American Chamber of Commerce paid for the ad. We just don't know that underneath it, it was Chevron Corporation, for example, providing the funds for that ad. That's called dark money.
Quando o senhor fala que a lei, quando a lei mudou em 2010, quando a Suprema Corte Americana mudou a lei, retirando, igualando as pessoas físicas, as grandes corporações, as grandes empresas do ponto de vista como deveriam ser vistas nas contribuições de campanha, mas, ao mesmo tempo, os mecanismos de investigação através das redes sociais são muito mais eficientes hoje. Será que apenas a mudança na lei pode explicar o crescimento dessas contribuições de dinheiro obscuro, de origem obscura, e o aumento do custo das campanhas?
The Citizens United decision is a primary factor that has motivated the flood of new money into elections. We know that by taking a look at the outside, the expenditures by outside groups, like the American Chamber of Commerce or super PACs, any of these political outside groups. What we saw with immediately following the Citizens United decision in 2010 was a fourfold increase in outside spending. Now, these outside groups are the groups that corporations want to launder their money through, so they remain anonymous. We saw a fourfold increase immediately following Citizens United, and that was with corporations just sort of dipping their toes in the political waters, saying, can we really do this? Can we really start spending heavily in elections and not be recognized as being the source of the funds? And they realized, yes, we can. So the next election, 2012, we saw another fourfold increase. So it's a primary motivating factor. It's not the sole factor, of course. Campaign expenditures have always increased from election to election, but we've never seen the type of catapulting of the size and the magnitude of these expenditures. And then what happens on top of that is when you have the threat of a corporation being able to suddenly throw $500,000 or $1 million into a campaign against a candidate, and the candidate realizes that threat exists, that makes all the candidates themselves frightened. And so they get in this fundraising war mentality, thinking, well, we got to raise funds because a corporation may suddenly carpet bomb me right before the election. So you've got the corporations throwing more money in there. You've got the candidates under pressure, feeling they've got to raise more money because they might get attacked. And as a result, we've got this fundraising spiral that is just going out of control. The primary cause is this unleashing of new corporate money in elections.
Eu poderia dizer, então, que quem tem medo da transparência são essas grandes organizações, na sua conclusão.
You know, I hate to sound partisan, but this is the way it's breaking down. Most of the new money that's been coming into elections has been supporting Republicans on Capitol Hill. So Republican members of Congress have been the primary recipient of this new corporate money, literally by a factor of 3-to-1 or 4-to-1. And so in Congress, even with Citizens United intact, Congress could pass a Disclose Act requiring full transparency of all this new money in elections. They could do it, even within Citizens United. And we have been pushing Congress to do so. And what has happened is the Democrats have voted yes for it. The Republicans, who have a majority in both chambers of Congress, the House and the Senate, have consistently and repeatedly voted no. They refuse to allow transparency of this dark money. They refuse to allow any regulation of this new money coming into politics because it's been in their benefit. It's really kind of a sad story, too, because, you know, with the McCain-Feingold law that opened, that created transparency, full transparency back in 2004 and 2006, the key architect of that law was a Republican, Senator John McCain. The Citizens United decision happened and all this new dark money started flowing in, helping Republican candidates, even John McCain has voted against transparency at this point. So it is partisan on Capitol Hill, but only on Capitol Hill, only in the Capitol. If you take a look at public opinion surveys across the country, voters, Americans everywhere, Republicans, independents, Democrats, everywhere across the country, overwhelmingly want transparency of money in politics. And they are overwhelmingly disgusted with all this new dark money just swamping our elections. So it's not partisan across the country, only for incumbent politicians on Capitol Hill.
O senhor diria, então, também que os mecanismos de investigação das irregularidades, dos crimes de lavagem de dinheiro, falharam por parte das instituições policiais dos Estados Unidos, da polícia, do FBI, das agências do governo?
Oh, yes, indeed. Well, first of all, the judiciary created this problem with the Citizens United decision. But the agency that could most step up to the plate and mandate transparency is the Federal Election Commission. This is the agency that monitors federal elections nationwide for all federal elections. It itself has the authority to require disclosure of money in politics. And what's happened is the Federal Election Commission has been broken, essentially, by namely Senator Mitch McConnell, who is the Senate Majority Leader. He has been against any kind of campaign finance reform laws all his life on Capitol Hill, and that's his right. He does not believe in campaign finance reform, and he does not believe in transparency of money in politics. But what he's done is he's realized that he can't pass a law ending all campaign finance reforms. He certainly can't get the American public to support it. What he can do is he can appoint three commissioners, or three Republicans and three Democrats on the Federal Election Commission. He can appoint three Republican commissioners to that agency who do not believe in the campaign finance law. And if they consistently vote not to enforce the law versus the three Democrats who vote to enforce the law, it's a deadlock vote and nothing happens. And that's what Mitch McConnell's done. You can see it in the statistics. If you take a look at the deadlock votes, you'd think with a 3-3 commission, there, you know, it would be a recipe for disaster that there would always be deadlocks. That was not the case. The FEC had functioned fairly successfully all the way up until 2008. From 1976, when it was created, up to 2008, there were fewer than 2% deadlock votes among the agency, meaning it was working. What happened was in 2008, Senator Mitch McConnell, appointed three new Republican commissioners to that entity, and the number of deadlock votes increased ninefold, from 2% to 18%, and has stayed that high ever since. Those three Republicans are people that Mitch McConnell screens to make sure that they will not enforce the campaign finance law, they will not require transparency, and he has single-handedly succeeded in ending transparency and creating dark money.
Nossa Suprema Corte aqui, o Supremo Tribunal Federal, em setembro do ano passado, decidiu que empresas, que corporações não podem mais contribuir para as campanhas, apenas pessoas. O que o senhor pensa disso?
Well, from the American perspective, you know, that would be the way that I would like to see it go. I mean, the American experience shows that once we got corporate spending in elections, any reasonable limits on money in politics as well as transparency completely collapsed. And if the American experience runs true for Brazil, the same problem would exist here. So when it comes to restricting corporate spending in elections, you know, it is a healthy development. And to tell the truth, I have to applaud the Brazilian Supreme Court. I mean, we have the American Supreme Court that ruled that it's unconstitutional to ban corporate spending in American elections. The Brazilian Supreme Court rules the exact opposite. It's unconstitutional to allow corporate spending in elections. They're coming from two very different, dynamically different perspectives, and one of them is clearly healthier than the other.
O senhor é um lobista de uma instituição, de uma organização não governamental que defende algo que aponta na direção da redução do poderio econômico nas eleições. E, por outro lado, uma outra instituição chamada Citizens United, que com o nome de Cidadãos, defende os interesses das corporações. Eu queria que o senhor falasse um pouco sobre a questão do lobista, que é uma profissão regularizada, lobista dentro do financiamento das campanhas eleitorais nos Estados Unidos. O que que diz a lei?
Well, lobbying has changed a great deal. We've gone through an up and down roller coaster ride. When I first started lobbying in the United States back in like 2002, 2004, I realized that I couldn't get a real lot done because what lobbying is supposed to be about, by the way, first of all, is to provide knowledge and information to lawmakers so they can make better decisions. It's supposed to be about the exchange of knowledge. And that was what I was trying to do as a lobbyist for Public Citizen. But other lobbyists, especially lobbyists representing corporate interests, found that they could be more effective at getting lawmakers to act their way by using money instead of using knowledge and information. So they would use money to wine and dine lawmakers. One of the corporate lobbyists named Jack Abramoff bought a restaurant right next to the Capitol where he provided free dinners and gourmet dinners to any lawmaker that wanted to go in there and get a free dinner and free wine. Jack Abramoff would provide free travel for lawmakers. He'd fly them to Scotland to go play golf. He'd provide them with sporting tickets to go to events. And so he was using money to buy influence, and he was very, very effective at it. I knew I had to try addressing that problem. And so we passed some reform legislation called the Honest Leadership and Open Government Act that banned gift giving by lobbyists, banned restricted travel that lobbyists could provide. And by doing that, we helped level the playing field a bit between us lobbyists like me who has no money, versus the corporate lobbyists. It helped level the playing field because suddenly all these corporate lobbyists had to join me going to the Capitol, go sit in the office of a lawmaker and try to give them information to persuade them to go a certain way on a policy. It's a big step forward, but then with Citizens United, and once again, it's this awful decision, Citizens United was two steps back because all of a sudden corporations could spend unlimited amounts of money. Well, who controls the corporate political budget but the corporate lobbyists do? They're the ones who tell the CEO how to spend the corporate money in elections, which candidates to support, which candidates to oppose. So suddenly the corporate lobbyists became kingmakers once again. I was giving a congressional briefing right after Citizens United trying to explain to members and staffers the meaning of the decision. And this point was brought home to me by one staffer who then asked the question, well, now that a corporate lobbyist can spend millions of dollars against my boss, how can I say no to a corporate lobbyist? So Citizens United has not only devastated the campaign finance system in the United States, but it's even undermining the integrity of the legislative process as well.
É diferente? Qual a diferença que existe nas eleições de meio termo, nas eleições legislativas, das eleições presidenciais? Há alguma diferença?
There's a difference in scale, obviously. In presidential elections, dramatically more money is being spent than in midterm elections. In terms of the strategy behind financing, the differences aren't that big. It's just a matter of public attention and scale. In the presidential election, there's so much more at stake. You're not just voting for the House and members of the Senate, but now the White House and, you know, the dominant leader of the country. So much more is at stake, which means much more money pours into the process. So the big difference is a matter of scale.
O senhor é definitivamente contra o financiamento de campanhas pelas empresas ou é apenas uma questão do limite da contribuição?
No, I am opposed to corporations being involved in elections. Elections should be, you know, should be the form of natural persons, people who can vote. You know, that's who it's all about. When you're having corporate financing of elections, first of all, you know, if you have unlimited corporate financing, you're just going to interject a lot of money in elections that really isn't even necessary. I mean, we know who the candidates are without having to have a $10 billion election. So you not only have an excessive amount of money in politics, but there isn't really even a justification for corporate spending or corporate contributions in elections. Because when we talk about corporate contributions, it sounds like we're talking about, you know, a corporate body somehow made a decision that that spending for or against a candidate helped Chevron Corporation. So the Chevron Corporation decided this. That isn't what's really going on. What's really going on is the CEO of Chevron is just making the decision, and he dips into the till of other people's money, the shareholders' money of the Chevron Corporation, and may or may not tell shareholders what he's going to do, and takes that money and spends it as the CEO sees fit. So when we're talking about corporate spending and corporate contributions, we're really talking about just allowing one individual who runs the corporation to have access to a huge pool of other people's money to spend as he or she sees fit. Unless, of course, the corporation sets up its own, you know, process of having shareholders vote on this and the board of directors involved in this. But most corporations don't do that.
Se o senhor fosse um médico e passasse uma receita para a doença das eleições chamadas o poderio econômico, preponderância do poderio econômico sobre aqueles que não têm recursos, que receita o senhor sintetizaria?
Three steps, three prescriptions. The first one is reverse Citizens United and ban corporate spending in elections. The second is to create full transparency of where all the money is coming from. Once you have a transparency of elections, you've set the floor upon which you can build the rest of the house of campaign finance regulations. Then once you have the floor built, then you can start instituting the campaign finance regulatory system that'll involve contribution limits and, best of all, public financing of elections. The cleanest elections will be those that can remove all that special interest money, wash it right out of the elections, and bring in public funds that have no strings attached. Public financing of elections is the ideal model.
Como funcionaria o financiamento público?
Well, a good model that I'm working with now in the United States that we're trying to get through Congress, and we won't until after the 2016 elections, is called the Small Donor Public Financing System, Small Donor Matching Funds. And that means for any individual, a natural person, who makes a contribution, a small contribution, say of $100, it would then be matched by 6-to-1 in public funds. So my contribution of $100 normally wouldn't mean much, you know, in this world of campaign finance. But when you match it with 600 more in public funds, suddenly I'm making a $700 contribution. Suddenly I'm one of these players. And so it's called the small donor matching fund system. Provide public funds to match small donations to empower small donors and make those of us who have, you know, average means of resources to offer a more significant player in the political process. That's a good model.
Dr. Holman, o senhor certamente contraria interesses fortíssimos de grandes lobbies poderosos, de grandes instituições, grandes corporações. E certamente eles já devem ter tentado alguma coisa contra a sua organização e devem ter atacado justamente, procurado atacar justamente aquilo que sustenta, do ponto de vista financeiro, a sua organização. Se o senhor me permite perguntar, em delicadeza, eu perguntaria ao senhor, quem mantém a sua organização?
Well, it is a war back in the U.S. It's between those types of consumer activist groups that'll be funded by by people around the country, usually through small internet contributions. You know, our average contribution at Public Citizen is very small. It's roughly about $35. And we take no corporate money and we take no government money. We work with groups that are very similar to that. Common Cause, the League of Women Voters, the Campaign Legal Center, a wide number of groups that operate on the same basis. They reach out to citizens, they try pulling in some small donations from those citizens to be able to pay for the organization, and we are the ones that are then fighting groups like the Chamber of Commerce and the corporate world, and for that matter, the Republican incumbents on Capitol Hill, trying to secure reasonable campaign finance limits. It's, it is a bit of a David and Goliath story, but sometimes we win.
Cidadania entrevistou Craig Holman, membro da organização Public Citizen, sobre financiamento público de campanhas eleitorais nos Estados Unidos. Críticas e sugestões, ligue para 0800-61-2211 para ver de novo este ou qualquer outro programa da nossa TV. Acesse senado.leg.br/tv. Obrigado pela atenção e até o próximo Cidadania.